Thank you very much, Dr. Nawal, for the introduction. A big, big thank you to dear friend Bansi and the entire team of DiaCon. And it's always a pleasure to be a part of DiaCon for the last number of years and waiting when we can be there physically and enjoy the warm hospitality of Bansi Bhai in Ahmedabad also. Hopefully next year soon for the DiaCon. So I'm going to talk to today about, as the title suggests, talking about dapagliflozin and its impact beyond sugar control or beyond glycemic control. It says, thank you, Astra, for the session also. We have come a long way in the management of diabetes. From the time we have been talking about sulfonylureas initially and added as an add-on to metformin, and then sulfonylurea showed problems related to hypoglycemia or beta cell exhaustion. Insulin was always one of the options there for a number of years, but insulin, everybody is not ready to take easily. Then came in the thiazolidinediones, which again acted wonderfully, showed path-breaking results in terms of insulin resistance, but again, because of side effects like edema and weight gain, could not achieve the benefits as much as required. And then came the good boys of diabetes, we call it the DPP-4s, which are excellent drugs, safe, neutral in more or less in all the effects, but did not show superiority when it comes to extra benefits for cardiovascular and renal protection. And this is where the SGLT2s and the GLP-1s came in, which became the game changer in the management of diabetes. And I'm going to take you over the next 20 minutes to talk about how dapagliflozin has changed the way we are looking at or has become the new game changer and a hope for management of diabetes in the future. So we know that the global prevalence of diabetes is huge. I don't think I need to talk to this audience about it. Number of figures have been increasing worldwide. If you see the trends across in all the continents and all the country, more or less we see the maximum cases increasing in Southeast Asian countries as well as in Middle East and North African countries where the burden is really, really huge. If you just see the percentage increase in number of cases over a period of time, expected figures to go as high as 700 million by 2045, with again the maximum rise which is expected to be seen in almost by 74% in Asians and Indians as well as in Middle East countries. Indians, we know, are in an epidemic of diabetes, but what worries us more is that with the huge numbers of diabetic patients that we have, what we also know is that most of the time, most of the patients are uncontrolled and do not achieve the desired target A1C. This is the data from the START study, which looked at the various dietary compositions where they enrolled patients from different diabetic clinics. But what they also found out was that only 33% of diabetic population had an A1C of less than 7 at that given point of time. 62.5% of diabetic patients were always above the target and with a PPG of above 180. So in spite of all the drugs that we use, there is still a residual risk remaining. There is still a significant area which needs to be covered just in terms of glycemic control also. Apart from the glycemic burden, what also troubles us is the correlation between different diseases, mainly talking about the cardiovascular, renal, and metabolic parameters together. There is there are a number of common etiologic factors which bind these three things together, be it the type 2 uncontrolled sugars, hyperlipidemia, the NASH, and obesity, all becoming risk factors for cardiovascular disease. Cardiovascular disease per se becomes a process which results in complications over a period of time and more or less comes at the last stage of the atherosclerotic process, presenting in terms of heart failure, acute coronary syndromes, and various parameters. And this all is bound together with the renal comorbidities. We know that patients with kidney disease are at an increased risk of cardiovascular disease, and patients with cardiovascular disease are at an increased risk of renal disease. And therefore, this cardiorenal metabolic continuum is something which needs to be targeted, which needs to be acted upon at different stages before it progresses further to the end-stage renal disease or progresses to end-stage cardiovascular disease with the help of drugs, which will help us in stopping this or progressing this further. The prevalence of heart failure has been huge. If you look at the data from heart failure, it has become one of the major cause for mortality. It has become a major cause for hospitalization for patients with cardiovascular disease. Way back in a few years back, the Framingham Heart Study also showed that the hospitalization for heart failure was one of the major causes. And this is the data where they have compared or looked at the prevalence of heart failure in patients with kidney failure, looking at patients with a GFR less than 60 and more than 60 with over proteinuria. And clearly the incidence of heart failure varied from as low as 24% to as high as 59%, depending on the GFR, with the decreasing GFR having more number of patients with heart failure. Vice versa, this is a meta-analysis which looked at patients with in the prevalence of kidney failure in patients with heart failure. Again, a meta-analysis of 57 studies showing the prevalence of CKD to be as high as 32%, and a meta-analysis of 28 studies investigating the worsening renal function showing the incidence to be as high as 23%. So what happened over the last few years is, from the time the SGLT T2s came in, initially, it was empagliflozin, which showed superiority, or which came up with a trial like EMPA-REC, which changed the way we looked at an anti-diabetic drug. EMPA-REC trial was originally designed only to look at non-inferiority for empagliflozin versus placebo, and done in patients with cardiovascular disease. 100% of the patients were primarily those with established cardiovascular disease. And the beneficial effect that EMPA showed was like a bonus effect. And people rose up to this and started looking at an anti-diabetic drug in terms of more as a protective agent also. This led to further studies. Canvas came in, where they enrolled patients with 35% of the patients with multiple risk factors also. That means more of primary cohort. And then came in the DECLARE, which is the largest study done with 17,000 patients with dapagliflozin, where they compared dapagliflozin to placebo. The difference in this study was that out of 17,000 patients, 65% of the patients were patients with primary risk factors or with multiple risk factors. That means they were more of kind of population that we see more in clinical practice. 70% of our patients in clinical practice are these kind of patients which we see. And therefore, it was interesting to look at the findings that comes out from this, whether the benefits of SGLT T2s is equally seen in this kind of population also. The primary safety endpoint was to look at composite of CV death, non-fatal infarction, and non-fatal stroke. It had secondary endpoints like renal composite endpoints and all-cause mortality, and also the several safety features were seen. It was an event-driven trial seen over 4.2 years, and patients were subjected to DAPA 10 mg versus placebo. Clearly, the advantages that DECLARE trial showed, proved that heart and renal complications are frequent, are seen early, and under-recognized in patients with diabetes. And it proved that the cardiorenal protection given by dapagliflozin is seen and well-established in this trial over 4.2 years. And what it showed was that it clearly showed a reduction in terms of hospitalization for heart failure and CV death, which was there, though it did not show the same effect on 3-point MACE. Now, the importance of this is that if you look at this analysis, look at the difference here. What it came out was that the heart failure hospitalization, which was not the primary endpoint that was seen in DECLARE, but it came out as a secondary endpoint. And it showed that along with other trials like EMPA-REC and CANVAS, the heart failure hospitalization benefit, which is seen, is equally seen or well seen in this population of patients with established ASCVD. All the three trials showed a benefit in terms of reduction. What is interesting is that in patients with multiple risk factors, the primary cohort population, EMPA-REC did not have patients, so no data could be taken out from that. CANVAS showed some benefit, but if you see the line, it crosses the unity and it showed almost a 15% increase, and so was not considered to be as statistically significant. And DECLARE was the only trial done where it showed a significant reduction of almost 36% if you look at in patients with multiple risk factors for heart failure hospitalization. So clearly, that was the only first study with multiple risk factors patient which showed this benefit, and it proved that dapagliflozin could reduce heart failure hospitalization in this subset of patients. What DECLARE also told us was two different things, that this kind of cohort, the primary cohort, is subjected to heart failure. It was always thought that patients with heart failure will develop heart failure only if they have had a cardiac event in the past. But this trial showed that patients with multiple risk factors are prone to heart failure. And secondly, there is a drug which can reduce heart failure hospitalization if used early. And this drug was dapagliflozin. If you look at the MACE benefits, again, MACE benefits were clearly seen only in patients with established ASCVD in trials like EMPA-REC and CANVAS, where the population was more of that. but in patients with multiple risk factors, none of the trial could show this remains benefits significant enough. The focus then shifted to heart failure because all the clinical trials done initially like CANVAS, DECLARE and EMPARIC showed this benefit of heart failure hospitalization to be reduced with the drug and the CREDENCE. And therefore, the thought came in that if these patients, all these patients who were in this trial had a heart failure or had an ejection fraction of more than 60%, if they could be benefited, what was the effect that could be seen in patients with a reduced ejection fraction? And therefore, we got studies like DAPA-HF, the EMPEROR Preserve, the DELIVER and the EMPEROR Reduced, where it looked at patients with established heart failure and subjected them to these drugs. And to look at the effect, whether these drugs can work on this patients with reduced ejection fraction also. So DAPA-HF was the first heart failure outcome study. Actually, it looked at patients with diabetes and without diabetes. The thought behind this study was again the same, that if the heart failure benefits can be seen in patients with diabetes, whether it can be seen in patients without diabetes also, and whether it can be seen in patients with the established reduced ejection fraction. So 4,700 patients over 18 years of age with or without diabetes, almost 55% of the patients were without diabetes in the DAPA-HF with a diagnosis of reduced ejection fraction, where less than 40% with an elevated proBNP were subjected to DAPA 10 mg versus placebo. They were all on standard of care with taking ACE, ARBs, as well as all standard medications for antidiabetic also. The primary endpoint was to look at the CV death or heart failure hospitalization, which was defined or by an urgent heart failure visit to the hospital. And the secondary endpoints was again to look at CV death or heart failure hospitalization. It looked at total and recurrent heart failure events. It looked at a change in consensus Kansas City questionnaire, which was marked from baseline to 100, and an improvement in score or near 200 was considered significant. And also it looked at renal composite endpoints of more than 50% sustained eGFR decline or ESRD or end-stage renal death. The findings in this, it showed dapagliflozinam clearly showed a benefit. It showed a reduction, a relative risk reduction of 26% in terms of worsening heart failure or hospitalization for heart failure over the top of standard of care. If you look at the absolute risk reduction, around 4.9%, the number needed to treat was around 21. That means if you need to treat 21 patients over a period of 2 years to achieve this one benefit or to achieve this one reduction. The important aspect to look at here is that the benefit of dapagliflozin was achieved very, very early as 28 days in the 4 weeks time. The hazard ratio for the benefit came down to as low as 0.51. That means almost 50% benefit was achieved in the first 4 weeks of the therapy itself. And over a period of time, it was maintained right till the end of the study. And therefore, what it tells us is that you need to use the drug early. You need to subject a patient to this drug early in order to achieve the desired benefit over a period of time. When they looked at the individual components in the study, the worsening heart failure event was reduced by almost 30% and the CV death was reduced by 18%. Now, again, if you compare this to the results from other drugs which we use for heart failure, drugs like ARNI in the various studies have shown a 20% relative risk reduction for CV death. And therefore, the reduction of 18% of CV death in this study really woke up the cardiologists. And they thought that if we can get this similar benefit by using a drug which has more or less in hassles, cheaper in cost than ARNI, and this with a benefit which is over and above the usage of ARNI, because this benefit was seen in patients even who were given ARNI in the trial. And therefore, it has made this drug an important tool to be used in patients with heart failure by cardiologists also. When they look at various subgroup analysis in the study, whether patients with diabetes versus patients without diabetes, again, the hazard ratio is more or less similar. That means the benefit achieved was in terms of heart failure hospitalization was seen in both subset of patients. And therefore, the mechanism of action was thought to be something different and not only related to glycemic reduction, because these patients without diabetes also could achieve the same benefit. It also reduced the secondary endpoints of CV death reduction by almost 17%. And again, an absolute relative risk reduction of around 2.3% was seen in this subset of patients. Now, when we compare DAPA-HF with other trials, though we do not have head-to-head studies, if you could just compare it with other SGLT T2 trials where we compared it with EMPEROR Reduce, which had a similar subset of patients with reduced ejection fraction, but 1,000 patients were lesser in this study. The CV death and hospital heart failure hospitalization benefits are more or less similar. The heart failure hospitalization benefits also more or less similar. But what the difference major was the incidence of CV death on the separately. EDAPA was the only drug which showed this reduction of 18% reduction of CV death, which was not achieved in the EMPEROR Reduce. It could be because of the lesser number of patients. It could be result of the trial design, but exact cause is not known. But that is the truth that it was the only drug which showed this benefit over a period of time. Coming down to the last, another trial called DAPA-CKD. Now, DAPA-CKD was a trial which looked at the effect of dapagliflozin comparing to placebo, again, to look at the risk of renal and CV events in patients with established CVD. Till now, trials like CREDENCE and other trials like CANVAS, DECLARE, and EMPIRE clearly showed that the benefits of SGLT2 were there in renal endpoints. But all the trials, the first three trials had renal endpoints as secondary endpoints, and the patients enrolled here were primarily patients with their CKD with the GFR above 60. Only few EMPIRE had very few patients where the GFR was less than 60. And therefore, again, this trial was designed to look at whether the benefits of dapagliflozin can be achieved in a patient with an established CKD. The patients enrolled here were with a GFR of up to 25 in this study. Is what was seen here. If you look at, or if you compare again to the CREDENCE study, where the GFR was up to 30 in this study, patients with and without diabetes again were enrolled here, subjected to dapagliflozin versus standard of care, with standard of care versus placebo, and it had the standard exclusion criteria. Also, all the patients were on maximum tolerated doses of ACE and ARBs for more than 4 weeks, and enrolled patients were also without diabetes. The primary outcome was to look at composite of CV sustained more than 50% GFR decline, end-stage renal disease, or progression to renal or CV death. And the secondary outcome was to look at composite of sustained more than 50% GFR decline, composite of CV death, or heart failure hospitalization, and all-cause mortality. Around 4,300 patients were randomized. Etiologically, number of the in the patients with diabetes, overall, the 58% of the patients had established diabetic nephropathy. Out of the type 2 diabetic patient groups, again, majority of them had nephropathy due to diabetes. And in non-diabetic patient group, there were different causes of nephropathy, which was diagnosed here. The primary composite outcome, again, was showed a 39% relative risk reduction here, again, with the number needed to treat 19 over a period of till the end of the study. There were 197 events in the DAPA arm as compared to 312 events in the placebo arm. Again, when you compare across different subgroup analysis, whether the patient had diabetes at baseline or no, whether the patient had an albumin creatinine ratio of more than 1,000 or less than 1,000, and whether the GFR was less than 45 and more than 45, more or less the benefits achieved were seen to be equal across in all the subgroups, and which proved that the effect of dapagliflozin was again independent of the glycemic benefits or in terms of the baseline CKD function, and it was mainly due to something else. The secondary renal specific composite endpoints also showed a reduction of 44% relative risk reduction in the DAPA arm with 142 events as compared to 243 events in the placebo arm. The secondary outcome of all-cause mortality also showed a significant reduction of 31% in the dapagliflozin arm as compared to the placebo arm here. Again, if you do the sub-analysis of primary and secondary outcomes by diabetic status, nothing much to choose, more or less showing equal benefits. In fact, more benefits seen in patients without diabetes as compared to patients with diabetes with a hazard ratio of 0.50 and a p-value of 0.24. Again, the renal-specific outcomes, again, more or less showed a similar picture with reduction of almost 40 to 44% in both the arms. Irrespective of the patients, again, the heart failure hospitalization benefits and the all-cause mortality benefits was also seen equally well in all subgroup analysis. Statistical significance achieved for both primary as well as secondary outcomes in the both the studies. In this study, for both primary as well as secondary outcome is what was seen here. So DAPA-CKD was the first dedicated renal outcome trial, mainly to look at efficacy and safety of an SGLT2 inhibitor. It showed a 39% relative risk reduction for primary composite endpoint, showed a 44% relative risk reduction for renal composite endpoint, a 29% relative risk reduction for composite of CV death or hospitalization for heart failure, and 31% risk reduction for all-cause mortality. Consistent with this benefit, what CKD, SINDAPA CKD tells us is that it can have an impact on all kind of population, irrespective of the baseline eGFR. Dapagliflozin was well tolerated in this subset of patients with not much, no major side effects seen. And DAPA CKD does build upon the evidence that dapagliflozin helps in prevention of heart failure hospitalization, which was seen in DECLARE as well as in DAPA HF. More or less, it expands the knowledge that we have that it can work in all kind of population. If you see the DAPA CKD and the GFR in DAPA CKD, the mean GFR is only 43, and still the benefit is seen across in all subset of population. The primary endpoint showed a similar result. No major adverse events seen as compared to placebo throughout the study. No increased risk of amputation and no increased risk of decay seen majorly. So to conclude, dapagliflozin with its initial with its insulin independent mechanism of action has demonstrated a significant reduction in A1C, blood pressure and weight. DAPA-HF and DAPA-CKD study shows us that not only type 2 diabetics but also without type 2 diabetic patients could get this benefit in reduction of heart failure hospitalization or CV death as well as composite renal endpoint. It is a well-tolerated drug in patients with heart failure or CKD. And for declared DAPA-HF and DAPA-CKD, it is clear that apart from glycemic control, we need to use this drug early, especially in all subset of patients. It may not be a patient with pre-existing cardiovascular disease, but use this drug early in order to achieve the desired effect and to achieve the best effect in order to reduce the complications. Thank you very much.